sing Chicago song better than Chicago. That was great. You got a choir member up in there. Now y'all do that when Jacob show up. Don't do that when he... That's clear. Get that cleared up right now. Everybody love trying stuff when I come. Alright. That was some great selections.
Praise the Lord.
Texas is just really killing it right now. We were just in Dallas and you had a guy in the corner cabbage patching to the song. This thing is really going up in Texas.
Amen, amen.
Man. The title of today's lesson is Casting Out Demons. And my name is Brother Antoine.
Amen.
And we, what's your name? Brother CJ. Y'all know Brother CJ.
Yes. That's my son.
Oh, wow. Okay. All right, here's Brother Junior.
No, I adopt him.
Don't mess it up. But today's lesson, Casting Out Demons, is a skill set lesson. This is a lesson to teach you some how to's and to get through some regular daily life type things. And I know that we've seen movies, I watch movies I love. They entertain me, right? But when you see exorcism or casting out demons and things like that, what you see is all this stuff where people touch him, boom, and then his face spins around and all that. Or you see these shows, these preaching shows, where they touch first, they fall all out. And that's all the dramatization of casting out demons, but that is not your everyday demon. Satan doesn't operate like that all the time. I'm going to show you some cases in the Bible where it is like that, but that's not the common case. See, that is the donut hole. It's not the donut, yes, right? Sir. So we come across the donut all the time. We don't come across. The donut holes are rarity. You don't come across them all the time, right? So you don't come across people calling you, asking you to do exorcism, right? Because, I mean, what am I going to do? Right? If you read the words to them, you didn't go out and be, hey, what else can I do? But that's the end of that monologue. We're going to get right down to it because we got a lot of ground to cover.
Amen.
Let's start at Luke 8. And forgive me, guys. I got other housekeeping rules. As most people know, I preach a sweat. So, you're going to see me hit this towel a little bit. Do not tell Brother Luke, okay? Because I do have a slight cold. I might cough and I might go, ah! But that is not.
Okay? Well, now.
Okay. So, hey, right? We here together. So, let's start in Luke 8 and 29. Luke 8 and 29. And welcome, if anybody new here, welcome to the Israel of God. While our interpretation is expressly prohibited, we come straight with whatever it says. We can't change it, that way it means we have no dog in this fight. Right? Luke 8, we're going to start at verse 29. Luke 8 and 29. Ready? Go ahead.
For he had commanded the unclean spirit to come out of the man, for oftentimes it had caught him. And he was kept bound with chains and in fetters.
Mm-hmm.
And he broke the bands and was driven of the devil into the wilderness.
So let me give you some background. So there was this guy, and we've probably seen people like this, and we just call them, we dismiss things and call people just crazy, right? And you see sometimes this guy, he was extremely strong for a certain reason, right? So he was bound in fetters and chains, and he would break them. Now, I don't know many people that can break an iron chain, but this guy could, right? Go ahead.
And Jesus asked him, saying, what is thy name?
Mm-hmm.
And he said, Legion.
Mm-hmm.
Because many devils were entered into him.
So Jesus knew directly who he was talking to. Mm-hmm. Jesus wasn't talking to the man. He was talking to the one behind the man, right? So when he said, what is thy name? He said, Legion. That's how, a lot of times, how angels work. You got to remember, these evil spirits are still angels. What did Jesus tell that Pilate? I can send 12 legions of angels.
Right?
Right? Because this is many. And they all on this one dude. Now, they're not inside of his body. But they are all in his ear. Do this. Giving him that extra strength. Now, watch it. Keep going.
31.
31, go ahead.
And they besought him that he would not command them to go out into the deep. Mm-hmm. And there was there a herd of many swine feeding on the mountain. Mm-hmm. And they besought him that they would suffer, he would suffer them to enter into them. Mm-hmm. And he suffered them. Mm-hmm.
So they asked Jesus, hey, can we enter into the swine, right? Those evil spirits. Keep going.
Then he went to, then went the devils out of the man and entered into the swine. Mm-hmm. And the herd ran violently down a steep place into the lake where they choked.
Right, so the herd, the swine was like, look, we can't deal with this, right? Because we know that animals communicate. If you notice, if you watch any animal planets at times, animals even have language and where they know certain things. If you listen to the birds in the morning, like they're having a conversation, right? So whatever they're speaking to these animals, these pigs don't want to have no part. They'd rather die, right? Go ahead.
When they that fed them saw what was done, mm-hmm. they fled and went and told it in the city and in the country.
Go ahead.
And then they went out to see what was done and came to Jesus and found the man of whom the devils were departed, mm-hmm. sitting at the feet of Jesus, clothed and in his right mind, and they were afraid.
Wait a minute. So now Jesus gets those evil spirits out of this man. The man is sitting there at Jesus' feet, clothed in his right mind. But what did they say? They were afraid. So look at the power of the service of God. They were afraid just because he was able to cast out the demon of that man. And this is such a small thing. Every servant of God is supposed to have this. But check it out. Let's see where, keep going.
36. Mm-hmm. They also, which saw it, told them by what means he that was possessed of the devil was healed.
So they went and told, hey, that guy Jesus down there, he healed that guy possessed. You knew the guy that was real strong, breaking all that stuff. You knew I, you didn't want nothing to do with him. Because you probably said, oh man, that's that crazy one right over there. Let's walk the other way, right? You knew about him. Hey man, Jesus healed him. So now that story is fanned abroad. But let's take a look here, right? And you see who's in charge, right? Jesus, he told them exactly what to do. The servant of God is the one that's in charge.
Amen.
Right? Let's go to Luke 10. Now Jesus is about to set his apostles up so they can handle this thing. Let's go to Luke 10. We're going to start at 1 and then we're going to skip to 3. Luke 10, 1 and then 3. Ready? Go ahead.
After these things, the Lord appointed other 70 also, mm-hmm. and sent them two and two before his face into every city and place whither he himself would come.
So y'all notice how many he sent? 70, right? So these are not the 12 apostles, right? Because people think, oh, that was just the apostles. These 70 people you don't even know, right? So if they 70 people you don't even know, what if you serving God, what you have? Keep. Let's go to verse 3. Go ahead.
Go your ways. Mm-hmm. Behold, I send you forth as lambs among wolves.
So he gave the message. Go your ways. I'm going to send you as a lamb among wolves. Pay attention to that. He send you among the lamb, among the wolves. Let's see what these wolves look like. Do they have four legs or two? Let's skip down to 16. Go ahead.
He that heareth you, heareth me. Mm-hmm. And he that despiseth you, despiseth me. Mm-hmm. And he that despiseth me, despiseth him that sent me.
So he said that to everybody. He that heareth you, that heareth me. But they're not really hearing me. They're hearing the Father. Right. So that's the power you got to walk in. Are you an agent for the Father?
Yes, sir.
Right? So he said, if they despise you, hey, don't worry about that. They're not despising you. They despise the one that sent you, and they despise the one that sent me. Right? Right? Keep going.
17. And the 70 returned again with joy, saying, mm-hmm. Lord, even the devils are subject unto us through thy name. Mm-hmm. And he said unto them, I beheld Satan as lightning fall from heaven. Mm-hmm. Behold, I give unto you power to tread on serpents and scorpions, and over all the power of the enemy, mm-hmm. and nothing shall by any means hurt you.
You see what he told them? Now these the 70. These not just the apostles. This includes you.
Yes,
he said, I gave you this power. He said, the devils are subject to you in your name. He said, hey, I'll say fall like lightning, man. And he said, I give unto you power to tread on serpents and scorpions and over all the power of the enemy. So you got to recognize who your enemy is, and you know this.
Yes, sir.
He didn't talk to Satan directly this time. That other time, he was talking to a guy, right? And so then he says, and nothing shall by any means hurt you. Go ahead.
20. Mm-hmm. Notwithstanding, in this rejoice. Mm-hmm. That the spirit.
Read that again. Notwithstanding.
Notwithstanding, in this rejoice. Rejoice not.
Rejoice not. This is a small thing. Go ahead.
That the spirits are subject unto you.
Uh-huh.
But rather rejoice, because your names are written in heaven.
So he said, don't even reach. This thing's so small, you're supposed to have it. It's like people, they, oh, you graduated high school. Oh, you graduated, you're supposed to. They get limo for high school graduation. How do you get a limo for college graduation? You're supposed to. You got to set the standard yourself. Right? You set the standard. This is, oh, I cast out a demon. You're supposed to. You serve God.
Come on now.
21. In that hour, Jesus rejoiced in spirit and said, I thank thee, O Father, Lord of heaven and earth, that thou hast hid these things from the wise and prudent and hast revealed them unto babes. Even so, Father, for it seemed good in thy sight.
So he said, you know, that's why, like I always make that quote that my friend Vernon said when Obama was president. He said, if I shook Obama's hand, he don't know who hand he shook.
Come on, now.
Because all the servant of God, he said, you revealed it to the wise. You didn't give it to the wise and prove the ones that's running it. You gave it to the babe. You gave it to us. So you got to realize what power you got. You got to know who you're walking in. And that'll probably keep you from doing the folly that you do.
Come on now.
Because you know what power you're walking in. Let's go. But remember, he said he's sending forth that sheep among wolves. But let's see what this looks like. Let's go to Genesis 4. Let's start and let's see who else have this power. Genesis 4 and 6. The Lord gave it to us all at the beginning. You're going to read 6 through 7. Ready? Go ahead.
And the Lord said unto Cain, why art thou wrong? And why is thy countenance fallen?
So we know this story. Cain wasn't, he had attitude problems, right? He wasn't delivering his offering his best like Abel was. That's what this is about, right? He didn't think on the Lord as a great God to do it in spirit and give his best. He didn't say, I got to give my tithes, whatever. So that's something to think about too, because the Lord saw that spirit right there. Now check it out. What did verse 7 say?
If thou doest well, shalt thou not be accepted? And if thou doest not well, sin lies at the door.
So he said, if you do well, you would be accepted, Cain. This wouldn't be no big deal. But if you don't do well, sin is lying at the door. And what else?
And unto thee shall be his desire, and thou shalt rule over him.
That's the kicker right there. You supposed to be ruling over him.
Yes.
But when you follow him, he's ruling over you. Look who was in charge in that situation between the legion of angels and Jesus. Jesus in charge. They said, hey, can we go to the herd and swine? They didn't jump into there. They had to ask permission.
Didn't they do it?
Yes.
You give the permission. So when they're taking over you, you have given permission. That's why he was told, Cain, you should have been ruling over him. Let's go to Matthew 10. Matthew 10 and 1. I'm going to tell them the story again. 10 and 1. Ready? Go ahead.
And when he had called unto him his 12 disciples, he gave them power against unclean spirits to cast them out and to heal all manner of sickness and all manner of disease.
See what he's doing? He said, I'm giving you power. How is he giving them this power? Through this word, through this knowledge. Hey, you can, long as you believe. Because if we had read above, and when we looked at Luke 10, Luke 8, it was all about the faith. So if they had the faith, so he's showing them, hey, you got power against unclean spirits. You could heal sick and manner disease. You could do all of this, right? This is what he's telling them. Now let's skip down to 16. Go ahead.
Behold, I send you forth as sheep in the midst of wolves. Be ye therefore wise as serpents and harmless as doves.
So he's telling them again, I'm sending you forth as sheep in the midst of these wolves here, right? But be wise as serpents. You got to have wisdom. But be harmless as doves. That means you don't have to be, man, that's so stupid, you ready to knock everybody out.
Right.
No, he said be harmless as doves. Right. You got to be wise. Look how Jesus dealt with them all, right? He didn't even yell at the legion of angels. If there was anybody to yell at, it would be these guys, right? he didn't say have knowledge and be puffed up. He said have wisdom.
Amen.
Be wise, right? Yep. Wise as serpents, harmless as doves. Go ahead.
But beware of men, for they will deliver you.
Whoa. I thought he said wolves.
Men.
So these wolves got two legs, right? Go ahead.
For they will deliver you up to the council, and they will scourge you in the synagogues. And ye shall be brought before governors and kings for my sake, for a testimony against them and the Gentiles.
That's right. Go ahead.
And but when they deliver you up, take no thought how or what you shall speak, for it shall be given you in that same hour what you shall speak.
You know why it's given to you? Because you study.
That's right.
It's not that you can sit up and lay up and then just, oh, the Lord has spoke to me. No, you read the word. You study. So now you don't have to worry about what question they're going to ask you. Because you're supposed to be the Bible answer man. So whatever question they ask you or whatever they come with, you know what the word says and how to handle it. And you also know if they scourge you and everything, you know that this is supposed to happen. Right? So you're not worried, right? You just got to deal with it. Keep going.
20. For it is not ye that speak, but the spirit of your father which speaketh in you.
Didn't he say, he that rejected you rejected me? Reject the one that sent me? Why then? Because you giving them the word of the father. Because you're supposed to be the agent for the father. You're supposed to be able to stand in the gap. That's how you're able to cast these demons out. Keep going.
And the brother shall deliver up the brother to death, and the father the child, and the children shall rise up against their parents, and cause them to be put to death.
Didn't he say, I send you as sheep in the midst of wolves? Look who your wolves are. These are the same people, your brother. It could be your mother. It could be your best friend. It doesn't matter. Satan is, he does not care. He is truly no respecter person. He does not care who he uses. He gonna use he going to use anything and anybody that's able to be used. He can even use you. It does not matter to you. As any time that it's available, he's going to take the shot. Right? Keep going. 22.
And ye shall be hated of all men for my name's sake. But he that endureth to the end shall be saved.
See that? It's he that endure. You got to endure this thing in order to be able to make it, in order to be able to be the one to cast out the demon for someone else. You got to be able to have endured this. Let's keep going. Let's go to Matthew 7. We're going to clarify some of this. You see that these wolves could be the person right next to you. He's showing you, hey, casting out a demon is not anything about just exercising against something. You go make somebody head spin. It's about dealing with this everyday life.
Right.
But all these people, even yourself.
Well,
Matthew 7:15. You ready?
Yes.
Matthew 7:15. Go ahead.
Beware of false prophets, which come to you in sheep's clothing, but inwardly they are ravening wolves.
Oh, they what?
Ravening wolves.
Oh, these wolves he's talking about. Anybody that's coming with falsehood that's got something against what the word says, and a lot of times it happens on regular stuff. It may be something so, because Satan is more subtle than any beast of the field. So it could be something real small that's happening in your life, or and you, the way you respond has everything to do with it.
Amen.
Is how are you going to respond according to the word of God, or are you going to respond according to you? And that's where he gets you. He's trying to check and see if you're going to respond for you, or you're going to respond according to the word of God. We're going to see it. Keep going.
You shall know them by their fruits. Do men gather grapes of thorns or figs of thistles? Even so, every good tree bringeth forth good fruit, but a corrupt tree bringeth forth evil fruit.
Keep going. What you say?
A good tree cannot bring forth evil fruit. Neither can a corrupt tree bring forth good fruit.
You see that? He says, so every good tree brings forth good fruit. So you got to listen to that behavior, or you got to listen to those words. Because every good thing, he said, a good tree cannot bring forth evil fruit, right? So you got to always keep your eyes on and watch your behaviors and words. Don't go around just, oh, man, yeah, he got evil spirit. He got demons. An evil spirit can come on anybody at any given time.
Well,
or he can work a room.
Right.
Believe me, You've seen men work a room. An evil spirit can do the same thing. So don't, but just be aware of it.
That's right, man.
So you got to first know what he said. Look at the fruit that is bearing.
That's right.
That's how you know what's going on, right? Keep going.
19. Every tree that bringeth not forth good fruit is hewn down and cast into the fire.
Mm-hmm.
Wherefore by their fruits ye shall know
them. By their fruits you shall know them. So those, if you wonder if someone is a wolf or being used by an evil spirit, by their fruits you don't know them. We're going to check this out. Let's go to 2 Peter 2 and 1. One way, the first step to making change is awareness. Making you aware, so because you don't know what to fight against if you don't even know who the enemy is or what it looks like.
Right.
2 Peter 2 and 1. Ready? 2 Peter 2 and 1. Go ahead.
But there will false prophets also among the people,
mm-hmm.
even as there shall be false teachers among you,
mm-hmm.
who privily shall bring in damnable heresies,
mm-hmm.
even denying the Lord that bought them,
mm-hmm.
and bring upon themselves swift destruction.
So he said, so we just saw that when Jesus talked about the false prophets. So now Peter is warning. He said, hey, there's false prophets also among the people. There'll be false teachers among you, and they bring in damnable heresies. Heresies is anything against the commandments of God. Anything against the word or the plan of God is heresies. That's what they call heretic. Right? So anything that's against that. So they bring in death. They privately bring in. How they do that? Hey, man, you know you're a really bad person. Right? Man, do you see it all? Especially when you get a class so big, you really get it. It's always somebody in the corner. Well, hey, man, no. I don't know. You shouldn't do it.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
And then next thing you know, that whole thing goes out.
Yeah.
We've seen it plenty of times.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
So they probably bring in damnable heresies, right? And denying the Lord that bought them. Like, man, you know it ain't gonna wash. That's how the Lord purchased you. He said, denying the Lord that bought them. The Lord purchased you with his own blood.
Yeah.
Ready? Go ahead.
Two. And many shall follow their pernicious ways,
uh-huh.
by reason of whom the way of truth shall be evil spoken
you
of.
You see that? So that's just what I was talking about. The way of truth is now evil spoken of.
Mm-hmm.
So this is letting you know that's the demons you're going to be casting out. It's not the guy spitting and have his head circling around like an owl.
Oh, yeah.
It's this guy bringing in damnable heresies. It's this person behaving in such a way that you know, oh man, this don't look like how a person that serves God should behave.
Yes, sir.
But and casting out that demon don't mean you gotta shout at him and all that. We're gonna this is a teaching lesson. It's gonna show you exactly how to do it.
Amen.
Ready?
Amen.
Let's go, let's start at the beginning and see where it all started. Verse 3, I'm sorry. Go ahead.
And through covetousness,
mm-hmm.
they shall with feigned words make merchandise
mm-hmm.
of you, whose judgment now of a long time lingereth not. And their damnation slumbers.
So he said, with feigned words, they're going to make merchandise of you. You know what that means? They can use you for a purpose.
Yeah.
Merchandise is like a medium of exchange, right?
Uh-huh.
For money, you get merchandise, right? So now they can use those words, get into you with feigned words, make merchandise of you. I can use you to do my bid.
Mm-hmm.
We're going to see it happen. Let's go right to it. Let's see where it first happened. Genesis 3. With feigned words, they can make merchandise of you. When I buy something with my money, that's my merchandise, right?
Yeah, oh, yeah. Right.
With feigned, so with these words, I'm going to purchase something. We're going to see it. Genesis 3, and he's going to purchase something off. He's going to get a big price for this one. Ready? 3 and 1. Go ahead.
Now the serpent was more subtle than any beast of the field
mm-hmm.
which the Lord God had made.
Mm-hmm.
And he said unto the woman, yea, have God said, ye shall not eat of every tree of the garden?
Mm-hmm.
And the woman said unto the serpent, we may eat of the fruit of the trees of the garden,
mm-hmm.
but the fruit of the tree which is in the midst of the garden, God has said, ye shall not eat of it, neither shall ye touch it, lest ye die.
So you see that the conversation, they said he was more subtle than any beast of the field, right? That means subtle is smooth. Right? So, you know, subtle defect, like this might have a small defect here, but you got to feel it just to see it, you know? Right? So he's more subtle on any beast of the field, then you say, hey, did God say you should not eat of every tree of the garden? Then she broke it down to him, right? Verse 4, go ahead.
And the serpent said unto the woman, you shall not surely die.
You shall not surely die. Pay attention, keep going.
For God doth know that in the day ye eat thereof, then your eyes shall be opened, and ye shall be as gods, knowing good and evil.
With feigned words made merchandise of you. See, these are feigned words. He said, God doesn't know. I got a little secret. See, it's just that God don't want you to know. Right? We love good, juicy gossip. Everybody does, right? It's a human thing. Man, somebody, man, let me tell you about this. Right? And so that's all Satan used. Well, hey, with his feigned words, God just knows that if you knew, you're going to be as wise. You're going to know good and evil. Right? And he don't want you to know about that. Right? Keep going.
And when the woman saw that the tree was good for food, and that it was pleasant to the eyes, and the tree to be desired to make one wise.
To make one wise, right? To make one wise. Okay, keep going.
She took of the fruit thereof and did eat.
Remember the Lord said, beware of their fruits, right? Beware by their fruits you shall know them, right? So she took of that fruit and did eat and did what?
And gave also unto her husband with her, and he did.
And made merchandise. You see that? Because now I just purchased the person that I really need. The thing was on Adam, it wasn't on me. The thing was that if Adam could have shut all this whole thing down, it was that's who he really got. So he used the liaison and made merchandise. With his feigned words, he made merchandise. Right? And he went that and death, he bought the whole creation.
Yep.
You see that? So now, but let's check it out, right? But remember what he said. You should, with those same words, you shouldn't surely die, right? Let's check them out again. Let's go to Matthew 16. Satan don't need to change because man don't change. He going to use the same thing. It's an emotional. We anytime you get way over in love this way, way over in hate, he can get you. He can get you. You watch it. Let me really see it right now. Matthew 16. Ready? Matthew 16, we're gonna start at verse 21. Matthew 16 and 21. Go ahead.
From that time forth, Jesus began to show unto his disciples how that he must go unto Jerusalem and suffer many things of the elders and chief priests and scribes, and be killed and be raised again the third day.
Now you check. Now, when you really read the word, you'll find out the apostles never wanted to talk about Jesus dying. Anytime the subject came up, they wouldn't even ask questions. Right. Like, no, we're not awaiting that day. Right? So Jesus telling them all the time, though, hey, I gotta go suffer many things of the chief priests. I'm going to be killed, and I'm going to be raised again the third day. They didn't pay attention to the raised again the third day. Yeah. There is no kill. Uh-oh, we're going to talk about it, right? So somebody got to say something. Go ahead.
Then Peter took him and began to rebuke him.
Uh-uh, Jesus. Go ahead.
Saying, be it far from thee, Lord, this shall not be unto thee.
When I tell you, when that emotion get way over, so it said, be it far from you, Lord, this shouldn't be. Oh, ain't nobody going to hurt you. Right? You're not going to die. Keep going. But hold on. What he say to him? You should not surely die. Same message. You should not surely die. Go ahead.
23. But he turned and said unto Peter, get thee behind me, Satan.
Get what?
Get thee behind me, Satan.
I thought he was talking to Peter.
No, sir.
Get thee behind.
You see that? So he said that spirit used Peter just like he used Eve with feigned words made merchandise of it. So he used a Peter. Now see what happened. He said, get thee behind me, Satan. Go ahead.
Thou art an offense unto me. For thou savorest not the things that be of God, but those that be of men.
Hold up. Why did he say you don't favor the things that be of God, but those that be of Satan? He said those that be of men. Satan is the ultimate salesman. He sells you on you. He sold Eve on Eve, and he sold Adam on Adam. Right? But that's how he got with feigned words made merchandise. die for you. He don't even think about it. He's selling you on what you want. So when it comes a time when you have to choose between what you want or what the Lord wants, what you gonna choose? Yes. That's how you cast out demons. Worry about this one in the middle. Yes. Let's keep going.
24.
Go ahead.
Then said Jesus unto his disciples, If any man will come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me.
Can we just cover that? You got to deny yourself. You really want, first before you start casting out other demons, you got to deal with this cross. You got to deny yourself. He said, so any man want to come unto me, let him deny himself. So now, when you want to deal with this, when you decide you're faced with that cross world, what should I do? Should I go and slap this dude? Or should I, right? You got to deny yourself, right? Go ahead.
25. For whosoever will save his life shall lose it. And whosoever will lose his life for my sake shall find it.
So when you thinking, oh man, I got to get mine, right? He said, you lose your life for my sake, you're going to find it. But if you save your life, you got to get this fleshly retribution, you're going to lose it. You have lost the battle. Right? Keep going.
For what is a man profiting if he shall gain the whole world and lose his own soul? Or what shall a man give in exchange for his soul?
That's the key. What you gonna give up in exchange for your soul? Remember, this conversation came right behind when Peter said to Jesus about not dying. Because Jesus knows we gotta give it all up. Yes. I cannot even afford to think this way, he's telling us. Because what I gotta give it all up for y'all. Right? That's what he's expressing to them. That's why he went right into this conversation. But let's keep going. Matthew 26. I hate my sweatpants. Matthew 26 and 38. Jesus breaking it down to them like, look, you gotta be willing to give it all up. So when it's coming in your mind of what to do that's going to be for your flesh, or what to do that's going to be for the word of God, which one you going to choose? That's casting out that first dude, right? Then he can't use you. He can't make merchandise of you because he know he ain't got nothing on you, right? Once he gets something on you, he going to make merchandise of you all the time, right? 26 and 38. You ready? Go ahead.
Then said he unto them, My soul is exceeding sorrowful, even unto death. Tarry ye here and watch with me.
Right, so he told them, hey, watch with me. Pay attention to that, right? But he said, my soul is sorrowful, even unto death. Right, keep going.
And he went a little further and fell on his face and prayed, saying, O Father, if it be possible, let this cup pass from me.
You shouldn't surely die. Oh, they got him too. Yeah. Didn't I tell you? He don't care who he goes for. So what makes you think he can't go for you? He willing to go for Jesus. Yes. You got to be aware. So what did Jesus do to cast it out?
Nevertheless, not as I will, but as thou wilt.
Oh, I'm going to choose the Father's will as well as my own will. Yes, right? Yes, I got to separate because these wolves are out here. Keep going.
And he cometh, we have ordered. And he cometh unto the disciples and findeth them asleep and saith unto Peter, what? Could you not watch with me 1 hour?
Hey man, you couldn't watch 1 hour. They sleeping, right? Because it's time to wake up. It is not time to sleep.
That's right.
That's what Jesus let them know. This is the time is now. And I'm telling you again, the time is now again. Right? So he said, wake up. Keep going.
Watch and pray that you enter not into temptation.
Oh, that you enter not into temptation. Keep going.
The spirit indeed is willing, but the flesh is weak.
Hey, this flesh is weak. He said, so watch so you don't enter temptation because he's coming for everybody. If he's coming for me, he definitely going to come for you. Right? So keep going.
He went away again the second time and prayed, saying, oh, my Father, if this cup may not pass away from
you, you should not surely die. The same message. Keep going.
Except I drink it, thy will be done.
I got to cast it down, Father. Your will be done. Yes. Keep going.
Yes, sir. 43. And he came and found them asleep again.
Sleeping again. Keep going.
For their eyes were heavy.
Keep going.
And he left them and went away again and prayed the third time, saying the same words.
You see how heavy it was? Because he was on them. You know what you got to go through. You don't want to do this. You know your flesh can't handle this, right? That's the same thing of whatever it is you want to do. So whether it's in anger, or whether it's in love, or whether it's whatever emotional state or whatever it is you want to do, that's when he gonna press you. And when he put that pressure on, boy, it's like like you're in a sweatsuit with a rubber hose. He got you sweat. Right? And then what choice are you gonna make at that time? Yes. Are you gonna choose, are you gonna say, not my will, but thy will? Yes. Right? Yes. These the real demons you gotta cast out. Yes. So if he ain't worried about Jesus, he sure ain't worried about getting on you. You nothing. Right? You a piece of cake. Ready? Ephesians 6. Notice they were sleeping. They wasn't aware. We trying to wake you up right now so you can become aware of this thing.
Amen.
Ephesians 6, we're going to start at verse 10. Ephesians 6 and 10, go ahead.
Finally, my brethren,
Be
strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Put on the whole armor of God.
I'm sorry, just wait. Ephesians 6 and 10, we're going to start over. Everybody got to use the computer. Ephesians 6 and 10. Ready? Go ahead. Start over.
Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil.
Oh, so this is now he's telling you how to do it. So he said, put on his whole armor so you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil, right? Because remember, he's more subtle than any beast of the field. And he don't show you himself. He's showing you you. So he's showing you what's going to entice you. Because it's about you, right? Keep going.
For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places.
So you got to see who you're dealing with. This is some spiritual wickedness in high places, and it can come from every level. And it's so high, it can use your daughter. It can use anybody. Right? Keep going.
Wherefore, take unto you the whole armor of God, that you may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all to stand.
You got to give it all up. Didn't Jesus say that? Whoever ain't willing to bear his cross, right? He said, hey, I got to take up my cross. The ones that ain't willing to do this, you not worthy of me. So he said, you got to do all to stand. It's going to take all you got. Keep going.
Stand therefore, having your loins girt about with truth.
With truth, go ahead.
And having on the breastplate of righteousness.
Righteousness. So if you're wicked, it won't work. You know, I'm going to show you sometimes what wickedness looks like. Wickedness looks like, I didn't do that. You know you probably done orchestrated something, said something for something to happen, but you keep your hands clean. Yeah. I didn't do nothing. I never said nothing. That's wicked. It won't work for you because it's got to be a complete righteousness. It's got to be transparent righteousness. No other way around. Right? Keep going.
15. And your feet shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace.
Go ahead.
Above all, taking the shield of faith.
The shield of faith, because they needed faith to be able to cast out those demons. Keep going.
Wherewith ye shall be able to quench all the fiery darts.
So when Satan's shooting over with those darts, when you got faith, they're not coming because he ain't got never know you. With vain words, he hasn't made merchandise of you.
That's right.
But once he makes merchandise of you, you have lost the faith and all those darts go hit. But when you got that shield of faith, when you have believed, even when it went against you, what you wanted to do, what was probably in your quote-unquote best interest, you ain't got nothing to know. I didn't side with you, Satan, to get my own game. Right. So you ain't got nothing to know me. I kept the faith.
Yes.
So now when the darts come, they just bumping off. Keep going.
17. And take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word
of God. You gotta keep that word with you. Keep verse 18.
Pray always.
Praying when?
Always.
Always.
You gotta always be praying.
Always.
Keep going.
With all prayer and supplication in the Spirit.
Because didn't Jesus keep saying, not my will, Father, but thy will be done.
Yes, sir.
Praying always.
Yes, sir.
Right? Keep going.
And watching thereunto with all perseverance.
Doing what thereunto?
Watching.
Watching. Did he keep coming back to you? Wake up. You got to watch with me for an hour.
Yes, sir.
You got to be watching. You got to be aware. You will not be able to block this thing if you're not aware. You gotta see him coming.
Yes, sir.
Right?
Yes, sir.
Keep going.
With all perseverance and supplication for all saints.
You see that? With perseverance, that means and when it's getting tough, you gotta keep on going. That's perseverance and supplication for all the saints. Right? So we're not doing this for ourselves. You're going through this so you can be able to help these brothers. You're not moving these mountains for you. He needs you to learn to move mountains so you can move them out of the way for somebody else.
Yes, sir.
You see how Jesus was able to get that evil spirit off that man? Because if you had read, they had been pressing him for 40 days and 40 nights, right? So he knew he suffered for somebody else. Now he suffered during himself, so he was able to move that on somebody else. That's how you'll be able to help somebody else with an evil spirit. You got to go through this.
Amen.
Let's keep going. Ephesians 5.
Amen.
5 and 14. He going to tell them again.
Amen.
5 and 14. Ready?
Yes.
Go ahead.
Wherefore he said.
Ephesians 5 and 14?
Yes, sir.
Okay, yeah, wherefore he said, right?
Wherefore he said,
mm-hmm.
Awake thou that sleepest.
What?
Awake.
Awake thou that sleepest. He keep telling them, you gotta be aware. You gotta wake up.
Right.
You gotta pay attention.
Yes.
Look, this word of God is for the thinking man.
Yes, sir.
It is not for the one that wanna lay up. He don't have time for the lazy. It is for the thinking man, the person that can think they way through these issues. We're going to show it to you.
Yes,
right?
Jesus.
Ready? Keep going.
And arise from the dead,
uh-huh.
And Christ shall give thee
life. Uh-huh.
See then that ye walk circumspectly.
Keep going.
Not as fools, but as wise.
He keep telling them be wise. Like he said, be wise as serpents, harmless as doves. So he said, walk circumspectly. Y'all know what that means?
Yeah.
You know, like circumference, circular circumcision. Look around you.
Yes.
Be aware.
Yes.
Walk circumspectly. Right? Keep going.
16.
Uh-huh.
Redeeming the time because the days are evil.
Because these days are evil. Yeah. That the time is now. That's why I keep telling them, awake. Go ahead.
Wherefore, be ye not unwise, and understanding what the will of the Lord is.
Be ye not unwise, but understanding what the will. It's the opposite of. Unwise is to not understand what the will of the Lord is. Be ye not unwise, but be understanding of what the will of the Lord is. Right? Go ahead.
And be not drunk with wine, wherein is excess,
mm-hmm.
But be filled with the Spirit.
Now pay attention to that. What do they call wine? And spirits, right? So don't be drunk with these spirits, but be filled with this spirit.
Yes,
right?
Yes,
don't be drunk with wine with these spirits. Be filled with this spirit.
Right.
This one spirit, right? Go ahead.
And be not, 19.
Mm-hmm.
Speak to yourselves in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs,
uh-huh.
Singing and making melody, amen. In your heart to the Lord.
Go ahead.
Giving thanks always for all things unto God and the Father in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ.
See, so he's telling them, hey, so you're going through something, this is what you're doing. You singing and speaking to yourselves in songs and hymns. You giving Lord the praise the whole time. Even that's how you're helping someone else. You got to get this right in you so you can be able to do what Jesus did, right? Let's get to it. Let's go. Let me show you how a person that got it right in themselves, they're going to show you how to do it. Let's go to number 16. We all like to do it like this, but I know I would every time, but we can't do that. Number 16 and 1. I like to do these stories for examples, because stories really is what help people understand certain things, right? So let's go through this story with Moses. He had already straightened himself out. And you're going to see the power that you really have when you're serving a God. You ready? Number 16 and 1. Number 16 and 1. Go ahead.
Now Korah, the son of Izhar, the son of Kohath, the son of Levi.
The son of who?
Levi.
So these not no punks in the game, right?
Well, now.
These the priests. Okay, the son of Levi, go ahead.
And Dathan,
uh-huh.
And Abiram,
uh-huh.
The sons of Eliab, and On, the son of Peleg, the sons of Reuben, took men.
Uh-huh.
And they rose up before Moses with certain of the children of Israel,
mm-hmm.
250 princes of the assembly, famous in the congregation, men of renown.
So these are the bosses, right? It said princes. Mm-hmm. People think prince just means son of a king. No.
Mm-hmm.
Prince means chief or captain or person that's over something. He's a prince, right? So he said, and men of renown, so these men are known, right? So in our day, you're talking about the elders, a brother Bowie and stuff. Men of renown, people that are known, right? Keep going, where are we? Verse 3.
And they gathered themselves together against Moses and against Aaron and said unto them, ye take too much upon you, seeing all the congregation are holy, every one of them, and the Lord is among them. Wherefore, then lift ye up yourselves above the congregation of the Lord.
With feigned words make merchandise.
Yes, sir.
So this is working, right? So now he's saying, hey, now they done jumped up, hey, you taking too much of yourself, right? With the whole congregation is holy. The Lord did designate Israel as holy. But see, that's how Satan used you. Just like how he did with Eve, that one little lie, and the rest some truth. So you taking too much of it. How they know what Moses? The Lord set up Moses. So that's against the word right there. But now he going to use the part where the whole congregation is holy. So that's the mix in you got to always watch for. Somebody throw the little truth out, and then hit you with the rest of the lot, right? So that's how he said, you should not surely die. God doesn't know. You either this, you're going to be wise, knowing good and evil. The rest of it was right. He did the same thing here. He threw out, you take too much of yourself, then he threw out the rest of it. Oh, yeah, the whole congregation. So that's going to get everybody riled up. Evidently, you got 250 of them going, right? Go ahead.
4. And when Moses heard it, he fell upon his face. And he spake unto Korah and unto all his company, saying, even tomorrow the Lord will show who are his and who is holy.
So what did Moses do as soon as he heard? He prayed, right? Because he fell on his face. He said, because how you know? He fell on his face. He came up with what the Lord was going to do. How was you going to know what the Lord going to do unless he gave it to you? Right? So he fell on his face and told him, hey, the Lord's going to show you who is and who is not. Go ahead.
And will cause him to come near unto him, even unto him whom he hath chosen, will he cause to come near unto him.
Okay, well, let's skip down to verse 13. Go ahead.
Is it a small thing that thou hast brought us up out of the land that floweth with milk and honey to kill us in the wilderness, except thou make thyself altogether a prince over us?
See that? So now he said, hey, it's a small thing that you done brought us out of the land floweth with milk and honey. You are a slave. He said, now you're going to make yourself a king over us, a prince over us, right? Keep going.
14. Moreover, thou hast not brought us into a land that floweth with milk and honey, or given us inheritance of fields and vineyards. Wilt thou put out the eyes of these men? We will not come up.
Oh, see, because Moses asked them to come up. And they said, hey, we ain't coming up. You think you're a prince over us? And plus, you done brought us out here in this wilderness. You're supposed to be taking us a land full of milk and honey. Who was Moses? Why do you really not remember? Jesus told you. You're not the, they don't reject you. They're rejecting the one that sent you. They're not rejecting Moses. They're rejecting the one that sent them. So when they're talking all this stuff, they really talk to the person that's behind Moses.
Lord,
right?
Lord.
So he's saying, hey, you know, you're going to put out the eyes of these men like you're blinding the people. Right? Like Moses, a false prophet or something, right? Keep going.
15. And Moses was very wroth and said unto the Lord, respect not their offering. I have not taken one ass from them, neither have I hurt one of them.
Did y'all check that? He said, and Moses, the meekest man in the land, was very wroth and said unto the Lord, respect not the offering. The Lord listened. You see the power you have as a servant of God? This guy got his act together. So when he said, the Lord, respect not the offering. Okay. Lord, he didn't come back, Moses. Who you think you're talking to? And you know the Lord will do that to them when Moses hit the rock. So evidently, Moses was dead right. So when you were serving the God, who going to come against you? You tell the Lord, hey, this person being wicked toward me, deal with him. Hey. You see that? That's how you cast out a demon. Now, we all would love to do it like this, right? But let's go to 28. Keep going. Come on.
And Moses said, hereby you shall know that the Lord hath sent me to do all these works, for I have not done them of my own mind. If these men die the common death of all men, or if they be visited after the visitation of all men, then the Lord hath not sent me.
So he said, hey, man, these die. They just die. They get canceled. Hey, the Lord ain't sent me. Y'all can stop following. Yeah. But what else? 30.
But if the Lord make a new thing, and the earth open her mouth and swallow them up with all that are appertain unto them, and they go down quick into the pit, then you shall understand that these men will have provoked the Lord.
Why he ain't say they provoked me? Because Moses acting in the stead of the Lord. See, Satan acts in the stead of man. So he said, hey, these men have provoked the Lord. If he called an earthquake to come and it swallowed them up, hey, you know, hey. And if wasn't there, you know, then the Lord has sent me. Other than that, if it don't happen like that, then the Lord didn't send me. Because Moses ain't about himself in this thing. Keep going.
And it came to pass, as he had made an end of speaking all these words, that the ground clave asunder that was under them.
You see how fast the Lord worked for a servant? He couldn't even get finished. Right, Susie? Boom! Bam! Right? Keep going.
And the earth opened her mouth and swallowed them up and their houses, and all the men that appertained unto Korah, and all their goods.
Man, their houses, everything that appertained to them, and all their goods. So be careful who you're rolling with. Right? You ready? That we love all the cast out of demons like that. But that's not how it always goes down. But let's check something else out. Let's look at Job. That spirit of disobedience that was on Korah and all them, that same spirit of disobedience was on Cain. That's the same one that keeps coming through. Right? Satan don't have to change because man is still acting this way. Let's go to Job 1. Let's check it out. You see, when you are serving God, you're the one in charge. You know what he said? Hey, the evil spirits are subject unto your name, right? Just same way with Moses. Don't respect their offer. Hey, if the ground clave asunder and deal with you, then you know the Lord ain't sending you. Boom, there it is. Because by the power of the servant of God, you notice that Red Sea didn't part to Moses. Put the staff out there. The Lord will operate for his servant.
Yes, he will.